De Havilland Mosquito was the first two-engine machine to land on an aircraft carrier. This is that touchdown on Indefatigable in March 1944. It had been equipped for deck landing and proved quite satisfactory. The arrestor hook. Rockets were also fitted to decrease the takeoff run. The rocket motors are jettisoned when all burnt. This picture shows the Mosquito doing crash barrier tests in HMS Triumph. The film is slowed down. By all appearances, wooden constructed aeroplanes would just seem to be unsuitable for this treatment. An historical moment, the last landing of the Swordfish on HMS Ocean during 1945. This is the only type of TSR machine in service during the Second World War, served the fleet well despite the fact that towards the end of its time it was completely outclassed as regards speed and performance. This same year, we see the first landing of a jet aircraft on the light fleet carrier Ocean. The aircraft is the de Havilland Vampire, and the pilot, Lieutenant Commander Brown, Winkle to his friends. The Vampire was de Havilland's first jet aircraft, and the first aircraft in Britain and America to exceed easily 500 miles per hour. The event is the cause of interest. Some very considerable interest. And it remained that way during that first trial. Here it is coming up from below, still surrounded and commanding attention. The pilot can be seen in the foreground without a helmet. Where does the urge come from? Feelings believing. With the engine starting up, there seems to be plenty of noise, a new and unaccustomed noise. Running up at full power before taking off. The spectators are a little more distant, behind something, somewhere. There was no trouble with a free takeoff. A new era had started and the aircraft had come to stay. Now we return to a new twin engine aircraft, the de Havilland Hornet, built for the RAF and adapted for naval use. These first trials took place on HMS Ocean during August 1945. The landing successful. Another landing, the batsman using his influence. The batsmen now were an accepted and essential part of deck landing technique. This naval version was equipped with folding wings for easy stowage and fitted with the necessary points for the tail-down method of launching. It also had air-hydraulic shock-absorbing legs instead of the compressed rubber-absorbing type to reduce bounce on deck landing. The two Rolls-Royce Merlin engines gave it a top speed of 438 miles per hour at 10,000 feet. It had an operational ceiling of 35,000 feet and a range of 3,000 miles. And so to bed. This machine with a tricycle undercarriage is new. An American, the Aero Cobra, the tricycle undercarriage claimed to prevent bouncing and ballooning off when deck alighting. These first trials are taking place at RAE Farnborough. The sea trials in Pretoria Castle. The Aero Cobra takes a measure of the deck during a flyover. this time a landing. The tricycle undercarriage did all that was claimed for it and later more fully developed. This particular machine was unusual not only in having a tricycle undercarriage, it also had the engine aft of the pilot with a long central shaft connecting up with the airscrew. This did give rise to vibration trouble. Now some real troubles. There's a chance of this machine and a near miss with a cine camera. This time a swordfish, off the straight and narrow, breaks a leg. Unfortunately, Professor Townend, who had been investigating airflow over deck problems, was killed in his albacore's attempt to land. The Hellcat comes in too quickly. The pilot seems none the worse. A firebrand bent on destruction. The failure this time, an unusual one. An arrestor hook. The machine, a mosquito. Picture-by-picture analysis of the slow-motion film proved very useful. With this machine coming in, one would think all is well. The arrestor hook contrives to bounce over each and every wire. There is evidence of the brakes being applied. The barrier serves a useful purpose. Unfortunately, with this firefly crash, a piece of the propeller struck the camera operator, who was seriously injured. The prototype Sea Otter that replaced the Walrus was first tested by the Navy during 1939. These trials are taking place in Triumph during 1946, when the finished machine, built by Saunders Roe, was in service as a general-purpose aircraft. It had a cruising speed of 100 miles per hour and a takeoff time from water of 24 seconds. A tractor-type propeller instead of the Walrus pusher type and carried full navigational and radar equipment. It was the last amphibian to be used in the service. This Sea Fury is doing accelerator tests at the Royal Aircraft Establishment during October 1946. The first sea trials were in HMS Ocean in 1945. It started life as specification N7-43 and was a Hawker Fury adapted for naval use. The trials of a Short Brothers Sturgeon, a prototype T-12, in Illustrious during 1947. This landing is particularly bad. The machine was the first twin-engine aircraft designed for the Fleet Air Arm and was intended to be a fleet reconnaissance bomber but was never developed as such. We shall see it again with Illustrious later. In 1945, tests commenced at the RAE to investigate the possibility of landing onto a flexible deck, machines without undercarriages to speed up their operational efficiency. These trials are of a Hotspur glider being catapulted onto a rubber deck in 1947. The water which was sprayed on acted as a lubricant. During the same year, a Vampire does a check run over an experimental deck built on the aerodrome. In this instance, the low fast approach is satisfactory, and the aircraft hooks onto the arrestor wire, making a good landing without damage. The first run is repeated, and a head-on view obtained to check the approach. Again, the end view. One can see the hook and watch its connection with the wire and subsequent arrest of the aircraft. In 1948, a flexible deck was constructed and fitted to HMS Warrior, where sea trials were carried out, again with a Vampire. Here is the first landing. And now a repeat. The object of the scheme was to quicken up the landing rate to 1 every 30 minutes, but this speed was never achieved, and the best obtained was 1 per minute. Having landed, the idea was to have the machine rapidly towed and handled onto a trolley where it could be ready for further use. This part of the test was not completed without some difficulty, and although as a whole the scheme was a success, and the saving of weight, cost and the additional speed obtained by using undercarriageless aircraft worthwhile, the idea has not up to now been developed any further. With the arrival of this supermarine attacker came the first prototype jet fighter aircraft for the Fleet Air Arm. It was originally laid down as an RAF fighter, but the second and third prototypes were fitted with deck arrestor hooks, long stroke undercarriages, etc., solely for naval use. This is the first trial taking place in Illustrious during October 1947. The specification was laid down in 1944 to provide a fighter that would use the new Rolls-Royce Mean turbojet engine. It went into production for the Navy in 1949. We saw the Sea Fury doing its preliminary tests at the RAE in October 1946. These sea trials are taking place in Illustrious during the year 1949. The Sea Fury 10 was fully navalised with its Bristol Centaurus engine, had a speed of over 450 miles per hour at 20,000 feet. It was, incidentally, the last piston engine machine produced for the Fleet Air Arm. These machines were a Hawker product, replacing the Seafire, and stayed in service till 1954. This is Hawker's first jet fighter, the P-1040, being tested in 1949 at the RAE on the arrestor gear. This first arresting is taken at normal speed. Again in slow motion. The prototype had a Rolls Mean engine and the first single jet engine to be fitted with a twin exhaust system. It was developed as a naval single seat fighter and later emerged as the Seahawk. The same machine during the same period doing catapult trials. The bad weather has no detrimental effects apparently on the launching. The display of water is not part of the procedure usually and is entirely due to rain. Another new venture, the Westland Wyvern, landing on Illustrious in 1949. This machine was designed for the Fleet Air Arm. It first flew in 1946, and not without some teething troubles. This version, finally fitted with an Armstrong Siddeley Python turboprop engine, drove contra-rotating air screws that were considered to be an advantage with deck landing technique. Now a free takeoff. Incidentally, the last machine produced by this firm for the Navy was the Walrus, used in the early 20s. We saw the prototype of this sturgeon make a bad landing on Illustrious in 47. Now, 2 years later, it is doing landing trials with the same ship. The first idea was to use it for bombing and reconnaissance, but it never went into production for these duties, and modified versions were used for target towing, photography, and other work. It had 2 Merlin engines driving contra-rotating air screws. This prototype Gannet, made by the Fairey Aviation Company, is doing its first rocket-assisted takeoff trials at the RAE in 1950. The first aircraft in the world to be fitted with a turbine engine driving double propellers so that each propeller could be independently controlled, making it ideal for ship use. Its duties were twofold. It could be used for reconnaissance or strike duties, and the large bomb bay would carry two torpedoes. All weapons were enclosed except those fitted to the wings. Again at the RAE doing arrestor trials. The double-member engine used with this machine and made by Armstrong Siddeley was designed to run on kerosene or the normal diesel fuel. This made it extremely suitable for the fleet air arm. Again in 1950, the first sea trials in Illustrious. This was the first time that a turboprop had ever alighted on a carrier. During these trials, three different prototype gannets completed about 250 landings between them. With the introduction of helicopters and autogyros in the early 1930s, it was thought that they could be usefully employed with naval vessels and merchant ships, but they proved difficult to handle near the deck, and they were not adopted till much later. These trials are taking place in 1951 with the merchant ship Fort Duquesne. The aircraft is a Westland Sikorsky Dragonfly. It was the first British-built machine to be used in the Navy, and was first based at Gosport in 1950. With these early trials, the use of helicopters proved one of their uses. The net on which it lands for these tests is evident. The same landing taken from the merchant ship, apparently successful despite the confined space and other hazards. The takeoff, too, without trouble. This type of machine now plays a very important role and is used extensively for rescue operations. It also replaces with more efficiency destroyers that normally attended aircraft carriers. The angled deck, devised by Captain D.R.F. Campbell, R.N., was developed by the Royal Aircraft Establishment, started life as a model of the Illustrious in 1951, and was then called the skew deck. Lines simulating an angled deck were painted on Triumph, but owing to its small size, no actual landings were made on her. Broadly speaking, the size of the deck and the airspeed over the deck had not increased much in the last 30 years, and carriers were beginning to show deficiencies with the introduction of jet aircraft, their faster speeds and increasing weight, with the need also of rapid takeoff and quicker handling. Here, a Blackburn GR-17/45 is doing a practice flyover. HMS Centaur was the first ship to be fitted with what was called an interim deck. The heavy cost of converting with a complete angle deck was temporarily overcome in this way. It meant extending the deck on the port side and adding a small extension at the starboard aft end. She did her flying trials in May 1955. This Supermarine Attacker was taking off from Eagle in 1954. We saw the first prototype, TS-413, during trials with Illustrious in 1947. They were the first jet aircraft supplied to the fleet air arm. Drop fuel tanks were fitted and they had a maximum speed of nearly 600 miles per hour. The first jet squadron was formed in 1951. At the same time as the angle deck was introduced, the batsmen were getting into difficulties with the faster landing speeds of the jets, and a stabilized mirror landing sight was introduced by Commander H.C.N. Goodhart, R.N., and developed by the RAE. At first, the long mirror gyro controlled to adjust itself to the pitch of the ship was set at the correct landing angle. It reflected lights that were aligned by the pilot so that the right landing angle could be achieved. The idea was generally accepted. These trials are in Albion during 1954. The first took place in Illustrious during October 1952. The Sea Venom, a direct development of the Vampire, landing in Ark Royal in 1954. It was the Navy's first all-weather jet fighter. The new mirror landing lights can be seen. A takeoff from Albion during the same year. This machine was initially developed from the RAF version and was fitted with the necessary catapulting and arrestor gear. Landing again. These machines took over or succeeded the all-weather Sea Hornet that had been previously used by the Fleet Arrow. The power plant consisted of a de Havilland Ghost with a thrust of nearly 5,000 pounds. It had four fixed guns and was capable of carrying eight rocket projectiles beneath the wings. The naval version was also equipped with power-operated folding wings. During the same year, a Seahawk, a machine first made by Hawkers and subsequently built by Armstrong Whitworth, was doing trials with Albion. Earlier on, we saw the prototype, P1040, doing preliminary tests at the Royal Aircraft Establishment, Farnborough. It was a single-seat fighter with a Rolls-Royce Mean gas turbine and a speed at sea level of about 630 miles per hour. During the SBOC show at Farnborough in 1957, 738 Training Squadron gave a fine acrobatic display with those machines. We saw pictures of the prototype Gannet performing at the RAE during 1950. Now these trials are taking place with Ark Royal in 1955. This aeroplane has developed into a three-seat anti-submarine search and strike aircraft. Its double-member engine with independently controlled air screws makes it ideal for ship use. It has proved itself and became a mainstay of the Fleet Air Arm for many years. A squadron of these machines also performed at the SBOC show, giving a clever display of formation flying. At about the same time as the new angle deck and the mirror landing aid, steam catapults were developed. One was erected at the RAE Bedford. Steam from the boiler is stored in the accumulator, and to launch an aircraft, the stored steam is admitted to the catapult power cylinders through these launching valves. A view from below deck and above. This catapult was developed by the Admiralty to supersede the cordite and compressed air propellant types, and it provided the extra speed required by the new jet aircraft. A de Havilland Sea Vixen that replaced the Venom is doing test on the steam catapult. The Navy's first swept-back wing two-seat fighter. Arrestor trials are also being carried out at Bedford, the year 1956. A single-seat fighter, the Supermarine Scimitar, doing trials at Bedford during the same year. It was developed from a prototype that first flew in 1954. Earlier prototypes of the straight-wing version had their first trials in 1951, the same machine undergoing arrestor trials during 1956. Two years previously, we saw a Sea Vixen doing trials at Bedford. Now, during 1958, it is doing sea trials with Victorious. The aeroplane, as we said before, was the Navy's first swept-back wing two-seat fighter, and was made by de Havillands. Fitted with two Rolls-Royce Avons, it reached a speed of over 700 miles per hour. It developed from the DH-110 and was finally adopted by the Royal Navy in 1955. The first landing trials took place with Ark Royal in 1956. Deflector flaps were fitted later to divert blast off the deck. The Scimitar that superseded the Seahawk has also been seen doing trials at Bedford. Made by the Supermarine Division of Vickers Armstrong Limited,
is now in Victorious again during 1958. A single-seat fighter capable of supersonic flight and the first fleet air-arm machine fitted to carry an atomic bomb. The Blackburn NA-39, the fleet air-arm's latest aeroplane, is here doing steam catapult tests at the RAE Bedford. Now, arresting trials. In September 1959, this machine could be seen at the SBAC show at Farnborough. Later, sea trials will be made on a carrier.